Hey, it's Grace here on Books and Cooks, and I just wanted to start out this video by saying I'm going through this like whole trying to figure out the lighting in this new house process, so it might be a little weird, so bear with me. And then I also wanted to say thank you to everyone who has followed me recently. I'm just so grateful that people are watching the videos, and particularly I love comments and I love engaging with everyone, and I really appreciate all of the comments that people have left recently. So I wanted to dive into the first of a bunch of videos I'm gonna make for December that kind of wrap up my favorite books of the last year. Yeah, I wanted to talk about in this video 5 of my favorite literary fiction works that I've read this year. So I will say, you know, I don't read a ton of literary fiction anymore. The last probably like 5 years or so, I've gone more towards reading a lot of genre fiction. So I didn't actually have a ton of books to choose from this year. But what is awesome is the 5 books that I have on this list, I adored all of them in different ways, and I would really pretty much unreservedly recommend them, you know, with a few caveats for content that I will try to let people know as I'm doing my reviews of them. So I'm going to talk about them in order of my basically 5th favorite, going all the way up to my number 1 favorite book of the year that I read that is literary fiction, or that I would categorize as literary fiction. So the first one that I want to talk about is The Cutting Season by Attica Locke. And this book is, I would say, a literary mystery or thriller. So it is still, you know, it has the plot structure and the trappings of a mystery or a thriller, but it has some really, I think, really interesting commentary about larger issues and larger questions, and it deals with things that are very, very interesting in an extremely well-written way as well. I think that the Attica Locke's writing is a step above a lot of mystery thriller writing that I have read. Sometimes, you know, mystery thrillers, when they're written well, can be very easy to consume and very like quick to get through, I would say, like kind of like popcorn style, but it's not always the most beautiful writing or the most evocative prose in those kinds of stories. And I would say that The Cutting Season by Attica Locke is an example of some really strong prose and some really interesting literary devices that are being used in this mystery. And this story, the basic plot, it follows Karen, who is a Black woman. I think she's in probably like her 30s or 40s, and she is a single mother living and working on a plantation, what was once a plantation, and it's now a historical site in Louisiana, I believe, in kind of rural Louisiana. And she is the manager for basically like the museum, and she also manages and oversees events that happen on this historical plantation site. She grew up on this historical site, and her mother worked there as well. And she attempted to try to go become a lawyer, and then ended up coming back and living at the same spot with her daughter. And so there's some really interesting like family dynamics at play. Additionally, she is a Black woman whose ancestors were enslaved on this property. And the sons and the man who own the property right now are the descendants of the former white overseer on the property. And basically, when she is, you know, wandering the grounds one morning doing her job, she comes across a body. And a woman, it appears that a young woman has been murdered. And this woman is an immigrant who's been working at the actual active farm right over the fence from the plantation. And it seems like she's been murdered. So then there's this, you know, ensuing investigation, and you follow Karen trying to figure out what's going on. And there's lots of twists and turns and sort of thrilling aspects that you find out about. And I loved this. I had so much fun reading this book. It really gave me a lot of really interesting things to think about in terms of I think expanding the way I have considered how Black people might relate to plantations as historical sites in the South, I guess it gave me a lot of things to think about in terms of why those spaces might be important to lots of people in the South, and both like in terms of their history, but also in terms of the economics of the South, why they may be important. So the fourth favorite book that I read this year for literary fiction is Women Talking by Miriam Taves. And this is one that I picked up kind of spur of the moment a couple weeks ago, actually. I read this very recently at the end of November. And this is a backlist book from Miriam Taves that I saw recommended by Nell, I think it is, on Bookunt. I don't know if that is the way you say that channel name. It makes me feel weird, but that's my guess of how you say the channel name. So anyway, I'll link her channel down below. Great review that she did of this book. It was like a vlog style review, and it got me really intrigued by this book. I'd heard people talk about it for a long time, a couple years back when it came out, but I never really caught on to like what was interesting about it. And I think the way that Nell describes the book just threw out some buzzwords that hooked me. This story, Women Talking, follows basically, definitely content warnings for this story outline, many of them. So it follows a community of Mennonites, like a small Mennonite community. And in this community, like leading up to the beginning of this book, women were being assaulted without their knowledge while they were drugged as well. So there were a bunch of women who were waking up, you know, harmed, or they had very strange dreams, disturbing dreams, visitations by like demons is what the religious leaders in the community tried to say it was, that they were actually doing something wrong. And so they were being visited by demons. But women of all ages, including actually young girls, like young children, were being assaulted by a number of men in the community, and they were being drugged before being assaulted. So lots of content warnings there. There is description of some of this in the book, although it's not in graphic detail. But the entire story is basically comprised of a chorus of Mennonite women's different voices. So primarily the women of two different families who were directly impacted by this abuse. And them kind of talking out and trying to decide if they're going to stay in the community or leave. Because what has happened following sort of the reveal of this abuse is that the men who did this have basically been protected by other men in the community. The men of the community protect the men by calling the police and having them taken to the city to be held. And then they basically tell the women, you have to forgive these men. We're going to the town and we're going to pay for their bail to bring them back to the community. And the only way for you to remain in the community is if you forgive them. And additionally, if you don't forgive them, then you will go to hell for this. So lots of religious abuse taking place in this book as well. So lots of content warnings that way. I don't want to get into like the details of everything that goes on in that book, but this is the setup for a conversation between these women where they're trying to kind of like parse out, are they going to stay in this community or are they going to leave? And there are so many questions, I think, that go into this conversation that are really interesting. The framing device for this book is that it's actually being written by a man who's in the community, who has his own kind of backstory that you find out about for why he's considered an outcast in this Mennonite community. But he's been asked to come and act as scribe for these women because none of them are literate. And they don't even speak, you know, the language of the country that they live in. They don't speak English. So if they choose to leave this community, they have, you know, they don't speak the language of the country that they live in. They don't know how to read or write or communicate, you know, through writing. And they have basically like no possessions, no money, no resources to help them leave. So I think it's a very, very compelling discussion of abuse and a very interesting container for discussing it. It is based on a true story, based on the author's note by Miriam Tave. So it's based on an actual event that occurred. And I think that she does a really good job exploring like a lot of the nuances in this scenario, and also a lot of the questions of like, what are these women actually going to do? Even if they do choose to leave, that is, you know, a huge decision in so many ways for them. And I think that that discussion really amplifies a discussion that needs to happen anytime we're thinking about people being abused who maybe don't choose to leave, right? Or who decide to stay in their situation. Perhaps the decision is not as clear-cut as some of us may think, who are more privileged in different ways, or who have, you know, different education or a different background. So very interesting, very compelling. I think it was very well written. The ending was mixed for me a little bit, which is why it's my number four, I would say. But I would love to hear from others who've read this book, because I would be interested in discussing it for sure. My third favorite book, and the only classic on this list actually, is Passing by Nella Larsen. I'm not surprised that I loved this book, but I think I'm surprised for a classic by how much I loved it as an adult, because unfortunately a lot of classics I've read as an adult, I haven't really enjoyed them very much. I might have like learned something from them or taken something from them, but I haven't always enjoyed them. And Passing I found to be both an enjoyable and really interesting reading experience as well. I've heard other people compare it in some ways to The Great Gatsby in terms of a lot of the themes that are going on in the story. So I think that is an interesting comparison, and also like the time frame is similar. So if you are someone who enjoyed The Great Gatsby, like that kind of like length of a novel and that sort of character study that deals with a lot of the same themes, I would highly recommend Passing for sure. And I think that it, honestly, reading it as an adult, I think it's a better book than The Great Gatsby. So I think that there's a lot to gain from it. It follows two friends. So it's a novella, and it follows two friends, Irene and Claire. They're both Black women in the United States. And Irene lives in Harlem, and it's like the 1920s, basically. Claire, I don't know that she lives, I think she lives in New York potentially, but they grew up together, and Irene is someone who can pass as white, but she has not done so. So she's married a Black man who is darker skinned than she is, and her children with him are Black. And she's chosen to kind of remain part of her community that she grew up with, and is very involved in that community and has friends and you know, people she sees who are Black, specifically. Claire can pass, and she's chosen to pass as white. And so she's married a white man who is a horrible racist, and would, you know, probably, you find out in this story, would be violent towards Claire if he knew that she was Black. And she has, I think she's had a child potentially with him. I can't remember if she's had kids. But anyway, these two women kind of re-enter each other's lives when they're a little bit older. And this story is about passing, in many ways. So I've heard and read some really interesting literary sort of reviews of this book, and I don't want to give away kind of the ending or what you come to find out in this book, but I will say that not only is passing as white a main theme of this book, but there's also a lot of thinking that passing as like straight or not a queer person is a major theme of this book, as with The Great Gatsby. Additionally, so it's very interesting. These women definitely have a very passionate relationship with each other. that I think is passionate in many ways, right? Like not necessarily always like romantically loving, but there's a lot of anger between them and a lot of angst, I think, and frustration with each other's choices. And you kind of follow the whole story from the perspective of Irene, who I think is a really interesting narrator for this story, and you get a very potent sense of how she is feeling throughout the story. So I would highly recommend it. I think it's a great book. And yeah, it was my number three favorite for the year. So my number two favorite literary fiction book of the year, and this on any given day, this probably could have been number one as well, because this is a book that has really stuck with me this year and that I've thought about since I read it this summer. And this is Salvage the Bones by Jesmyn Ward. This book, I'm so happy that I finally read it, because it did solidify Jesmyn Ward as one of my favorite authors writing at this time, especially for literary and nonfiction at this point. I think she's fantastic. And this book follows the main character, Esh, who's a teenage girl living with her family in Mississippi. And it's her and her dad, and then her three brothers, and her mother has passed away. And so they're definitely like a working class Black family. They live in a very rural town where most of the people seem to be working class in this town, this community. And the story follows the few days leading up to and then kind of going through Hurricane Katrina. And so it's harrowing in many ways. I think it's a really gorgeous family story as well. Esh is kind of has been treated in many ways since her mother passed away as like one of the boys, and she spends her time with her brothers, and they're all kind of like a little bit you know, not always super supervised by their dad. It seems like he is distracted by other things, like providing for them in different ways or trying to keep them safe from the storm that's coming. And he's not always like super checked in to how they're doing emotionally, it seems like. So there's a lot going on. And then you also have this sort of like countdown to Katrina as well that you're dealing with. There's a lot of like family dynamics, really beautiful brother-sister relationships, I think, which I don't know that I've read a ton of those that I loved so much. I actually think this book and my number one had some really great brother-sister relationships that really stood out to me and that I enjoyed. But yeah, I thought this was a great book and I would definitely highly recommend it. My number one favorite book of the year is Olga Dies Dreaming by Xochitl Gonzalez. This book, I actually kind of thought this might be my favorite book when I read it. And so it's exciting to me that it continued to stay so high in my mind in terms of enjoying it. This was one that immediately kind of captured me, and I loved the character of Olga, but also really enjoyed reading from the perspective of her brother Prieto. I think that their brother-sister dynamic is really fantastic. And complicated, and like, you know, I don't know, just it felt real to me, which I also loved about the last book. So I guess that's one of my buzzwords these days, is a great brother-sister dynamic. But basically this follows the character of Olga and her brother. They are Puerto Rican American, sort of like mid-30s, I think, or early 30s. People who are living in New York City, and they have, you know, they have a very interesting background, really. Their mother is basically a kind of a, like a revolutionary who left them when they were children, and took off to kind of run the revolution, essentially. And she stays in touch with them, but it's a very one-sided exchange. So she sends them letters and they have no idea where she is or how to talk to her. They just get these like one-sided commentaries on their lives and their choices based on her sort of like network of friendly spies that are passing her information about them and kind of what they're doing. And Olga works as a wedding planner and like event planner. And she basically, like, her thing is, I want to make as much money as I can and also not work that hard for these rich people, really. So she, I think she's like a fan of a good con, I would say. And she's also very like no BS about sort of what making money can do for their family. She's very practical about that. Even though she's also someone who has this very strong belief system, I would say, and in some ways like a very strong like moral foundation, she really doesn't struggle with kind of, I don't know, taking money from rich people. She's got kind of a bit of like a Robin Hood thing going on, I would say. And then her brother is a politician, and he's like he's been called like the Puerto Rican Barack Obama, right? So he's very much sort of that young, fresh-faced, more progressive politician, but he's making concessions, and he's also essentially leading a double life, you come to find out, in many ways. And so it's a very interesting and complex sort of conversation about these characters. I love a character study, and I think this book does that really well. And there's also like different romantic entanglements going on and different kinds of reveals about, you know, information and stuff going on with the revolutionary mom as well. So it's all, you know, all kind of like leads up to this really interesting sort of explosive conclusion with, I think, a lot of interesting things to say about these characters, which I very much enjoyed. I hope that that was somewhat coherent. I feel like I'm rambling about it, but that was my favorite book of the year. I really highly recommend that people pick it up. I don't think I've seen enough people that I follow anyway talk about this book, and I think that many people would love Olga Dies Dreaming. It's kind of flying a little bit under the radar for BookTube from what I've seen, so I would highly recommend it. And fingers crossed, hopefully this video uploads. My internet is very slow at this new house, so it's been a struggle to try to get it up on the internet, but I'm gonna try. So have a good one.